What's going on, guys? I thought we'd kick back and do something a little different at the beginning of this podcast. Before we start, I wanted to show you guys one of my favorite Super NES games. The one I'm talking about is WWF WrestleMania, the arcade game for Super NES. So, without further ado, let's pop this sucker in and enjoy some old school 16-bit wrestling. Oh man, I always loved this game as a kid. It was made by the same guys that brought us Mortal Kombat. You can definitely tell once the game starts. You know, for such a great game, it's a shame that it's only a one-player game. If only there was a game I could play with someone else who just enjoyed these classic games just as much as me. I need to do some research.
Who are you?
Everybody, this is Shane Wildcat Parsons coming at you with the Pro Wrestling Power Podcast this week. Welcome to the Monday Night Raw Rundown. Well, it all starts out the way it has the past couple of weeks. It's been brilliant, though. Rollins and the former Buddy Murphy. Now just Murphy with the AOP. So I'm just going to be Wildcat from now on. We're just going to drop any other extra name. Diamond Dallas Page will be Page from now on. That's just what we'll do since WWE's doing this for whatever reason. He's just going to be Joe. No more Samoa Joe. Just how it's going to be. But, it's weird. I don't get it. Maybe Buddy was too happy to be a heel, I guess. Buddies aren't heels. I don't know. Anyway, they're out in the ring. Rollins, the tag champions. I forgot that they were the tag champions because they haven't defended that yet. But we'll get to that, too, as well. But now, with the AOP out in the ring, they're gloating over winning the six-man tag match from last week. Of course, Seth Rollins is ignoring the parts where he cheated to help them to win. Because that's what good heels do. That's how it works. Of course, hearing his name, Kevin Owens, comes out because that's how it works. Beginning of Raw, somebody says your name, you walk out. It's just a rule. He comes out with the Viking Raiders. They start a fight. And Joe returns to the ring. He locks Rollins in the Kikina Clutch. It sets up an 8-man tag to close the show. We step into Becky Lynch versus Asuka. again. It's a great match. I mean, they're two of the best performers in the business. Asuka is one of those that could probably get in there with a broom and make it look convincing. She's that talented. Becky works really well with somebody that's good in the ring with her. I don't know if she's ready to lead that yet or not, but she's getting to that level. Of course, Kairi Sane outside doing her usual random heel stuff. And this is one thing that I like about the Japanese wrestlers. They get the psychology of it. You know, all the... they get that it's a show. You know, that they throw the performance out there. The heel antics of Kairi are almost make it worth watching the entire match. She almost makes you believe that Asuka could win. But we all know better. It's really weird that the tag champs... Yeah, I almost forgot that they were the tag champs as well, because they've been part of Becky Lynch's story. They're unfortunately just part of the program to put Becky over. I get it. You're trying to build for WrestleMania. Can we get them in a storyline too? They're two of the best performers on the roster as well. But the big moment... Well, one of the big moments. Shayna Baszler comes out. She beats the mess out of Becky. Bites the back of her neck. There's blood. Can we get Gangrel to manage her? Because that would be brilliant. You know, she comes out all brood-like. Coming up from the floor. All replaces Edge and Christian that way. But it's a great moment to sell Baszler. It's just crazy and dangerous and all this stuff. And just that image of her with the blood on her face was there's gifts there. It's something that's going to be remembered. Hey, look, the Street Profits still wrestle. They don't just sit in the back and do bad jokes and like random night show parodies. And they won in really quick fashion. But again, another weird spot where you have people that are bit players in somebody else's story. This was really all about the 24/7 belt. That Riddick Moss, after a roll-up, a schoolboy roll-up, and moves undefeated, people. he rolls up Mojo Rawley and goes out into the crowd with the 24/7 belt. Where is this going? I'm intrigued to see where it's going, but it's just kind of, you know, random moment. You figure Mojo's going to carry it for a while because R-Truth carried it for a while, and there'd be back and forth and all that. Like, they kind of treat it as a gimmick title, which is, it's great. It's usually entertaining TV. So, I'm intrigued. Where are we going with this? I like it. Then, we go to a segment where Becky Lynch is in the back talking to medical professionals, and rather than get in the ambulance and go with them, she steals the ambulance. Because the world of wrestling. I mean, we're trying to create Stone Cold Becky Lynch. She's good, but I don't know if we're ready for that kind of a level of stuff. I mean, is that the only way she could have got there? Because I'm sure the ambulance people are paid to do that. It's kind of actually why they're there. Oh well, what do I know? I'm just sitting on YouTube talking about wrestling. Hey look, after I said last week we should get more MVP appearances, we did. He was there with the talk show because, of course, nobody could just go to the ring and cut a promo. We got to have fancy chairs, and everybody's got to have their own little spin on a talk show that works with their gimmick. I mean, and it's, the whole thing was to put over Drew McIntyre. And I like it because he's showing more of a comedic side instead of just being a big, you know, Scottish psychopath. Like, there were bouncers in the aisle. He shoves his way past the bouncers, kicks over the ropes, and gets into the ring, and they're talking. Every time somebody would say WrestleMania, Drew would point at the sign, which is just brilliant. It's funny. It's like Pee-wee's Playhouse. You'd have the word of the day. So, that was their word of the day, WrestleMania. Let's point at the sign. Only that one says wrong, but you get the idea. Of course, MVP talks about how dangerous Brock Lesnar is and how Paul Heyman's the mouthpiece. And He offers to beat Drew McIntyre's Paul Heyman. And he pushes it and starts running his mouth a little too much for Drew, and Drew headbutts him and kicks his head off for his effort. So, yay MVP. Good seeing you on TV again. I hate this for... We got Angel Space Filler Garza. He's just here because Andrade failed the wellness test, you know. But he's growing on me. Dude's a great performer. Against Cedric Alexander. Of course, Humberto comes out, attacks Garza. But it doesn't matter. Angel on Hell, or Angel Garza. We'll just call him Garza. We'll go with that one name thing. He beats Alexander with the wing clipper. I like Garza. He's growing on me. I wish that we wouldn't have to call him a space filler. Can we maybe put the belt on him at WrestleMania? That would be a fun moment. I like it. We get Rhea Ripley. She comes to Raw. She's trying to see if Charlotte's going to challenge her for a belt. And Sarah Logan. Poor Sarah Logan. Appears at random, angry at Ripley. Because she's talking about wrestling on a wrestling show. I don't get it. It was probably scripted. We'll talk about that more later. And, of course, we get Sarah Logan jobbing out to Ripley in about 10 seconds. Yay, she was on TV. Boo, they're jobbing her out. She's one of those that you could probably move to SmackDown, where there aren't as big of a name, or as big of names, and actually start pushing her. Young, you know, she's younger. She's actually pretty solid in the ring. She might need a mouthpiece because she's not a great talker. But there's something for the future there. I like her work in the ring. Then, of course, Rhea and Charlotte talk back and forth. We're getting that at WrestleMania. They made me kind of care about it a little bit more. I still don't see why Charlotte had to win the Royal Rumble. Sometimes I think predictables are good. There's so many more stories we could tell, so many better things that we could do. Charlotte's going to be around for a while. She could have won the Rumble later. Because we know she's going to, because her last name's Flair. Anyway. There's a Lana and Lashley segment. They're talking in the backstage and mad because, you know, he don't have the shot at Lesnar. The Super Showdown, and there were no Rusev missions, which is criminal. We built and built and built this story, and it needs to be Rusev Day. You don't steal a man's wife and beat him up and beat him up and beat him up and retribution not happen. It just needs to be a thing. Hopefully this gets fixed next week, because I really want that WrestleMania moment with Rusev. He deserves it. He's one of my favorites. I'll openly admit it. But it's because he's earned it being a great performer in the ring. And seriously, who gets over something as silly as Rusev Day? Because every day is Rusev Day. That's a thing. But Ricochet beats Bobby Lashley clean. Which is huge. Because you wouldn't have thought it would have been clean. But we got to get Ricochet over as a threat to Brock Lesnar. And then, of course, we get the now traditional rough Ricochet promo. WWE scripts suck. If somebody sucks at promos, let them work on it. Don't hand them a piece of paper and say, this is what you need to say. This is what you need to read. This is the... Because if somebody else writes it for them, it doesn't come across as genuine. And most of the great talkers in the history of wrestling been genuine. That's what made them great. Arn Anderson. He looked like a guy that would win a bar fight. And that's basically what he talked about. Ric Flair. You know, wine and dine and jet flying. He looked like he would steal your woman back in the day. So you believed it. You know, Dwayne Johnson. The Rock. He, probably one of the best talkers in the history of ever. Turned him loose and he said what was on his mind. CM Punk, he got over because he ran his mouth. not scripted. So, can we just let people be people? Ricochet's been in the business long enough. I'm sure he could be serviceable if you give him a little creative freedom here. Then we get a Becky medical update. Cool, we're telling a continual story throughout the show. I like that. Then probably the best angle on Raw right now, get Randy Orton out in the ring. And he's explaining why he did the Edge, what he did to Edge. And he's interrupted by Matt Hardy, who wants an explanation for what Randy did to Edge. Because he was mad that that Orton stole Edge's second chance. You know, about all the rehab, all the work, all the neck surgeries, all the fights, argument, all the work and effort. He feels that Orton made him waste it. So, of course, they brawl. RKO, Concerto, and Randy, they booed the roof off the top of the building, and it was great. So much heat. And not Baron Corbin heat. This is like he earned it for being a good heel, not for being a terrible human being. Or at least that's the kind of heat that Baron Corbin gets. It's a thing. Which I don't get. He's a great heel character, but people hate him. So that's the comparison we have to make there. So many questions here. If you want to know why Randy did what he did, why did you interrupt him when he was talking? That makes not a bit of sense to me. The only reason he didn't explain it was because you walked out. But in a bigger thing, is this how we write the broken one off of WWE TV? Because there's so many rumors he's going to be talked about by my man Retro Joe in upcoming weeks as he switches to another company. So is this how they do it? Is this how it happens? I guess we'll just have to find it out. Ruby Riott, a confusing promo, because yay, another script. Not a fan. Come on, guys. Even if the promo sucks, if it's them talking, it'll be better than script. Just say it. Now, Aleister Black beats up Tozawa again. Cuts another similar program promo about he's going to go find fights, and he still hasn't. No, being in the ring with him is like being locked in a cage with an animal, and I don't get it. Can you find somebody for him to be in a program with? It's not hard. Got a big roster. Is the U.S. Championship doing anything? Haven't seen in a while. Anyway, of course, Becky drives the ambulance back to the arena. Yay, felonies. No cops, no nothing. She just drives the stolen ambulance back. Calls out, Baszler warns her that she is angry. Talks about, she's just talking about she's going to beat her tail. And it ain't going to be pretty. And I love the direction with the total show narrative. The fact that they started with this story and they've told it all the way through. This is some old-fashioned WWE when it was at its best. Even kind of WCW feeling when it was at its best. You start with the NWO, they're kind of in the middle of it. You know, there's one common thread throughout the whole show. And I like that. And they close kind of with the similar thought process. So we had the promo at the beginning to set up the 8-man tag, we end with a 20-minute match. And it's great. It's a lot of high spots. There's a Kevin Owens cannonball off the top rope to the outside onto like 46 people. I mean, basically everybody that was there. And they come up with a really creative finish. I like it. Whoever wrote this, give them a raise right now, because it protected everybody involved except for maybe Murphy. But he's part of the tag team champs and part of this big heel group, so even that's negligible. So Murphy's in the Kikina clutch, Joe's about to win, and somehow he gets hit with the curb stomp. So the heels sneak away with the win. Another angle where I'm just going, okay, where are we going with this? And why am I so invested in this? Why do I care where this goes? Because overall, Raw is with a couple of little bumps here and there. They've been great the past couple of weeks. I wish I could say the same thing for SmackDown, and we're going to come up with that review next.
It is better to give than to receive.
Give it to him good when WWF WrestleMania slams out of the arcade and into your home.
To thine own self, be true.
With the most true-to-life wrestling you've ever seen.
Love thy neighbor.
Bob Hurts and the World Wrestling Federation.
Do unto others.
Do it to him first. WWF WrestleMania, the arcade game for leading home systems from Acclaim. No pain, no gain.
Hey guys, this is Wildcat. Remember Raw. We have to keep that going. Coming at you with the SmackDown Review of the Week here on the Pro Wrestling Power Podcast. It's behind me. I'm fat. I get it. We start with a moment of bliss. On the ramp with Nikki Cross is apparently Bliss's sidekick now. Getting kind of weird with this. Their guest is Carmella. It was awkward. They started with some celebrity crush talk. I'm a little insulted because these blue eyes couldn't even get a mention. I mean, come on. Anyway, Carmella is sad that Bayley used to be her friend, and Bayley comes out, and it all sounded like some middle school argument you'd hear in the hallway. Oh no, this boy don't like me. Oh no, we're gonna fight over, I don't know, My Little Ponies or whatever they're arguing about is. He used to be. It's awkward and weird. But it led to a good match. There were some champ and peril spots that were really well done. They worked well in the ring together. Carmella had her in trouble. Bayley rolls out of the ring. There's this weird, if you watch WCW back during the NWO era, there's a weird NWO-ish glitch in the screen. I don't know if it's storyline. I don't know what's going on. But Hogan will be on later. So maybe there's a tie-in. Who knows? Bayley won with help from the ropes because she's a dastardly heel and she can't win clean. Because it keeps Carmella strong for the potential feud that's been set up. Of course, Naomi, she comes in all aglow. And next week, we get Carmella versus Naomi, a number one contender match for the Saudi show. I'm looking forward to it. It's good that the women are getting, they're getting to be on the show in Saudi Arabia. That's a really new thing for that area. So I like it. Call it good. Of course, Corbin has been banned from the building for pouring a drink on a fan's head. We know how well that'll work later. If you believe it, I'm sorry. It's still real to you. I get it. Bayley has cuts a promo about she's going to beat whoever wins next week. You're done. There's a Lacey Evans segment where she's talking about how fans will write her letters, and she will take those letters and put them in her boots for inspiration in her matches. And she's talking about one letter that somebody wrote her about her battle with addiction and how seeing Lacey Evans helped her battle her addictions, because Lacey has some of the similar struggles. I like how they're trying to make us care about her as a face character. It was genius. It was great. Let's have more of this. I like it. Keep it going. Otis and Tucker are getting ready for Otis's date with Mandy Rose. Tucker tells him just to be yourself. It'll be enough. Then we get Shorty G, Apollo Crews, and Sheamus. And Sheamus beats them both. Because, of course, Sheamus beats them both. Not sure about this booking. Both are young talents. Apollo Crews is one of the most athletic people I've ever seen in the ring. Shorty G is one of the best technical workers I've seen in a while. So why are we putting over Sheamus instead of young talent? I know Sheamus is supposed to be the bad guy, but he's still getting cheered. They were actually the crowd was wanting Sheamus to win. But I don't understand why they're being fed to, dare I say, future Hall of Famer Sheamus. He don't need the rub. He don't need the help. So, I don't know, maybe it leads to somewhere good where they get their wins back. I don't know. We'll find out. There's a Carmella promo talking about how she's going to win. A little angry, but yeah, that's really about it. Carmella talked a little bit. Then we get Hollywood Hulk Hogan. He's on the big screen. I'm not sure that they pulled a Goldberg from last week and advertised he would be in the arena, which was shady. But he's all NWO'd up, and he's reminding everybody that it's for life. And he repeated for life. Probably about as many times as he said it on WCW TV. It's a lot. Then Bray Wyatt interrupts with an NWO advertisement, NWO-esque advertisement segment. If you remember, they have the TV show commercials and be like, this portion of the program is brought to you by paid advertising. The new world order. You know, it was great. Of course, it sets up Firefly Funhouse. And Bray walks into the string, all air guitar in the belt, in true Hollywood Hulk Hogan fashion for back in the day. He's the best thing on SmackDown right now. That's not even close. Yeah. Watch it. It's a great segment. Hogan was putting over Goldberg. I'm not even entirely sure where we go with this. The NWO are getting put in the Hall of Fame. That's too sweet. And that's really... I want to know what they're doing with this. Because Hogan was putting over Goldberg hard. And we know we got the Goldberg Fiend match at the Saudi Showdown. So I'm intrigued. I want to know. Is Hogan going to screw Goldberg out of the belt? Is Hogan going to screw Wyatt out of the belt? What are we doing with this? Why insert Hogan here? There's good intrigue here. This is almost so good it could have been on Raw. Really. Then they have strong back-to-back segments. Because Sami Zayn and Cesaro are in the ring doing protest songs. Sami Zayn with his ukulele, and Cesaro had more cowbell. It was brilliant. Of course, they've been feuding with Elias, and Elias, we all well know, starts to try to play a song that gets interrupted. Well, that's what happens here. Elias interrupts. It's nice to see the tables turned. I liked it, the irony. Some more random glitchiness when Elias is on his way out. He actually lets Sammy and Cesaro play. So, they're playing. Sammy actually turns and tells Cesaro, we need less cowbell. Nice reference there. I like it. And, of course, Elias jumps in, starts to get beat up. Braun comes out, helps him, and they launch a security guy. Like, just dump him. It was brutal looking. Almost Rey Mysterio lawn dart type thing. It's bad. There's a Naomi promo talking about how she's going to win and setting everything up next week. Then we have Otis's big date with Mandy Rose. And he walks in. He's got his tux on. Of course, sleeves off because he's classy. He's got his roses. And he starts over there. And Dolph Ziggler's got his hand on Mandy Rose's shoulder. Poor Otis. I feel for you, man. It's rough. He drops the flowers and leaves. All brokenhearted. Dolph, nobody likes you. And if they're setting up a Otis, Dolph Ziggler thing, I'm all for it. Dolph can work with anybody. He's been underutilized in his career. So many stop-start pushes. I'm a fan. And I love Otis's charisma and where he's going with it. Then we end it with Roman Reigns' Daniel Bryan against The Miz and Morrison. If you could ever get an ending to a show wrong, I believe they did here. You have... Okay, Baron Corbin, of course, shows up since he's banned. He's sitting out ringside. Miz and Morrison are your number one contenders for the tag championship. They lose to Roman Reigns and Daniel Bryan. Why? All to continue the feud that will not end. Yes, it goes on and on, my friend. Some people started feuding, and we know who it was, and they'll continue feuding forever just because. This is the feud that does not end. Oh. I mean, come on, SmackDown. You love overbooking finishes. This is a spot you could have, and you could have protected everyone. You have Corbin interrupt before the match is over instead of letting Reigns hit the Superman punch and spear and Miz. Of course, this is the kind of stuff that gets people not liking Roman Reigns, because he traditionally just gets overbooked and pushed to the moon. Of course, it makes him look super strong. They beat the tag champs. And if Corbin interferes during the match, then Roman and Bryan can lose and nobody's hurt by it. The number one contenders don't look weak because they lost to some random tag team that got put together backstage. What are we doing? Why are we doing it? Honestly, outside of the Bray Wyatt and the Elias stuff, this show was pretty hard to watch. I mean, Sammy and Cesaro were great. Wonder where Nakamura was. Kinda missing the Glorious One, Bobby Roode. I mean, they could have been the tag team in this spot against Reigns and Bryan, and it not hurt anybody if they lose. They lose all the time. That's, I think, their only purpose on SmackDown anymore. Anyway, all that aside, I have the privilege, nay the honor, to send you guys on over to see what's going on in the world of AEW and NWA. That's right, the one and only Retro Joe.
And welcome back, NWA Power this week. So, we've got a few things to discuss here. We've got the Crockett Cup coming up in April, and you may have seen already that Nick Aldis will be putting up his belt against Marty Scurll. Dealer versus the Villain. Now, before, there was an announcement that Aldis wanted Marty Scurll to put up something of value. So, originally the idea was, if Marty loses, then he's going to have to refund everybody's ticket in that place. Didn't believe that was going to happen, but hey, what are you going to do? Storytelling, TV writing? You got to do something that may or may not happen. I didn't think that was going to go through. So the counteroffer came through with Marty Scurll at Ring of Honor. So what's going to happen is, Marty Scurll, if he loses, he's going to pay Nick Aldis, write him out a check for $500,000. So, we'll see what happens. Will we have a new champion? Only time will tell. So, this week on NWA Power, little wincing going on because every week's been pretty great, but this week, honestly, I have to say, not so good this week. They really didn't bring the heat. The storytelling was lackluster. But, hey, it happens sometimes. Not every show's amazing. If you've been watching wrestling for many years, you'll understand that. You know, you don't get 10 out of 10s every single time. Before we start with match one, I want to announce that we're going to do a different rating system this week. It's still a 10 out of 10 score system, but we're going to have the Macho Maniac give you your ratings for this week. So you'll get so many yeahs out of 10, per se. Anyways, match one of the night was the Dawsons with Pope versus the Bouncers with Eddie Kingston. This match, worst match of the night, match one, worst match by far. The Bouncers are going to win this via the blackout finisher. It's a double finisher that they do. Honestly, I'm going to give this one 3 machos out of 10, and I'll tell you why. The whole match was very slow, very sloppy, a lot of botches. 3 out of 10. That's all you get. 3 machos out of 10. Anyways, moving on to match two of the night, we had Tim Storm versus Tom Latimer. Tom Latimer will take the win via a DDT finisher. I'm going to give this one actually a 6 years out of 10. This match wasn't amazing, wasn't bad. It was an old school match done by the numbers. Match number 3 of the night was the TV Tape Championship match. Well, I'm going to have to explain this real quick because if y'all haven't been watching NW Power, this is how this works. This TV Championship is a brand new belt that they brought, that they actually brought back. They used to have it back in the day. Ricky Starks is the current TV champion. And how they do this is there's a timer they put on the screen, and it's a 5-minute timer. And what happens is if you can win within the 5 minutes, you win the belt. But if the time expires, belt is successfully defended. So Ricky Starks will hold on to the belt if he gets in 5 minutes without, you know, getting pinned. So anyways, just like last week, same thing happened. This one was Matt Cross versus Ricky Starks. I actually do like Ricky Starks. I think he's a pretty talented wrestler. Matt Cross, not so much. Ricky Starks is going to take this one again this week via the timeout. Now, like I was mentioning before, there's a special stipulation, okay, on this TV championship. So they call it the Lucky 7 rule. So if Ricky Starks successfully defends for 7 matches in a row, what happens is he gets a title shot versus the current heavyweight champion. So it might be Nick Aldis, it might be not. You know, it just depends on, you know, who has it at that moment when he hits him 7 matches, if he gets to it. I gave this one a 5 years out of 10. So this is actually match 2. He won last week. He defended successfully. This week he also defended with that timeout. So this is 2 out of 7. So, you know, 4 more, 5 more matches, and then he gets a chance at the heavyweight championship of the world. Match 4 of the night. We have Melina versus Tasha Steelz, who is actually a newcomer. She's the first time on NWA Power. This one was an okay match. You know, pretty standard. Melina actually was pretty good in the ring. Tasha's brand new, so it just depends. Like I've said before, if you're a veteran and you're really good, you can put people over. You can make their bad wrestling look better. Melina actually, she's a veteran in that sense, so, but she's not, you know, super veteran levels. You know, she's been around a long time, but it just depends. I mean, there's some people who put anyone over, and there's some people who can kind of put people over. She kind of put Tasha over in this match. Melina did win via the Primal Scream finisher. I gave this one a 6 years out of 10. Now, moving on to the final match of the night, we have Nick Aldis and Royce Isaacs versus the Rock and Roll Express. Yes, you heard that right, the Rock and Roll Express. They still fight, they're still on NWA, and they've still got it. You're going to hear that in the audience a lot because, hey, they're old, they love what they do, and they're still doing it. What can I say? If you like to do something, do it as long as you want to. Nick Aldis and Royce Isaacs will take the win via a heel pin with the legs on the ropes. Surprises me? No, not really. That was actually one of the best matches of the night. I gave it a 7 years out of 10. You know, everybody in the audience was doing the You Still Got It chant, which, hey, being as old as they are, doing what they do, they definitely still got it. And now we move on to AEW Dynamite. Oh my goodness. Oh man, oh man. This may have been the best show I've seen so far. I mean, I really don't know what to say here. Dynamite, you know, I've loved it since the beginning. I've been on board with the whole idea since the very beginning of this show. It brings back so many memories for me. It's like, I missed a lot of WCW, and I rewatched a lot of it later in life. And I feel like, I mean, I know a lot of people's gonna say this, but this is like almost like the rebirth of WCW, but doing it the right way, you know. Like I said before, I mean, a lot of people, they will script their stuff, but for this is not a script, this is just me. I feel like almost like I'm a teenager again, getting to rewatch something that I missed. So this show is getting better and better and better, like every single week. This week was top notch. I mean, it was just top notch. I don't even know how to describe it really. I'm just gonna jump right in and do the best I can with it. So AEW Dynamite for this week. All right, so first things first before we do it. So the pay-per-view of Revolution is coming up here at the end of the month. And they're building it in a way that is very, very significant, if I have to say. So John Moxley right now is feuding with Chris Jericho, and he does have the title match. So what's going on is the Inner Circle is basically trying to tear down Mox. So when he gets to Revolution, he's just, you know, destroyed, hurt, whatever. I mean, that whole thing with the eye gouge that they did. I mean, it's like great storytelling. I don't know what I really want to say about it, man. It's just crazy. They're building it up every week, and every week Mox tearing down the walls, killing layers of the Young and back one by one of the Inner Circle, and man, I don't know what's gonna happen. I mean, I would love for Mox to take the belt from Jericho. It's probably not gonna happen because of the way they're building the company. Jericho's the biggest draw of the company, so you know, I don't really see him losing it in Revolution, but you know, we've been surprised before. It could happen, you know. We'll see. Another thing for going into this thing, so Cody's had this feud with MJF, you know, from since like about four or five weeks ago this happened. So if y'all haven't been watching, MJF was Cody's best friend per se, and then MJF turned on Cody, causing him to basically never be able to challenge for the heavyweight championship again. So that was at the Jericho match, the first, you know, big title match for AEW. So anyways, so what's going on is, you know, Cody wants this, he wants this rematch, you know, not really a rematch per se, but he wants revenge on MJF for doing what he did. But MJF is basically telling him he's got three stipulations if he wants to fight him. So number one was, basically, so Cody had to take 10 lashes from MJF, which he did last week. Great, done, finished, moving on. Number two is he has to face Wardlow next week on Dynamite in the first ever AEW steel cage match. That's gonna be fantastic, you know, super. I mean, I'm so excited to see this. Third requirement is that Cody can't touch MJF. Basically, you know, no big deal. Anyway, so far he's met the requirements. If he beats Wardlow and doesn't touch MJF till Revolution, revenge match is on. So, moving on. Match one of the night. We've got the tag team champions with Kenny Omega and Hangman Adam Page versus SCU. This was actually a championship match, one of two for the night. Kenny and Adam will win this match via, check this out, double finisher at the same time. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I've never, ever, ever seen this happen. I mean, it probably has, but I can't really recall it happening. So basically, Adam hits the buckshot lariat while Kenny Omega hits the V-trigger at the same time in the middle of the ring. Amazing. This match was, I don't know how to say it. I didn't see a single botch in it. You know, the storytelling in it was great. The charisma was great. The back and forth with the baby face versus the heels, which there wasn't really any heels in this one, so I retract that. SCU is not really I don't know. They kind of are because they've got the whole thing with, you know, this is the worst town I've ever been in. They're kind of like a weird neutral heel slash baby face, so. Omega and Page are obviously the baby faces. They're a straight cut baby face team. SCU's in that weird neutral area, so yeah. But anyways, it was a great match, you know. Great moves, great hot tags. Amazing, amazing match. I give this one 8 years out of 10. Match number two tonight. Dustin Rhodes returns to his hometown versus Sammy Guevara of the Inner Circle with Jack Hagar. So this one has a little storytelling behind it too. Dustin Rhodes got his arm broken by Jack Hagar way back, you know, a couple months ago or whatever. And Dustin's been trying to get him to have a revenge match. Now, we haven't seen Jack Hagar in the ring yet since he's joined the company. He's just been like a crony of the Inner Circle, you know. Anyways, Dustin Rhodes will take the win via the Final Reckoning finisher. Guy gave this match a 7 years out of 10. Now, at the end of this match, something funny happened. This is pretty funny. So, as Samo was trying to, you know, skirt his little butt out of there, you know, after he took his embarrassing loss, you know, Jack Hagar was standing there looking at Dustin, and Dustin, you know, grabs the mic real quick and yells down the ring, I don't really say this because I don't really curse on this podcast. I try to keep it, you know, a bit family friendly there. So anyways, Dustin hollers down at Jack Hagar, "Hey, where you going, Jericho's B-word?" Hilarious. Hagar was sitting there, oh god, Hagar was like, he's just losing his mind, like, you see him turn red, he was like wanting to get in the ring, so, yeah, I think Dustin's little call-out cemented that whole storyline for the revenge match. Now, after this, we found out that Dustin will face Jack Hagar. Yes. He will be in the ring. I'm saying Jack, sorry guys, it's Jake Hagar. Y'all know him as Jack Swagger for WWE, so. This will be his first match for AEW in the ring. Will be fun. Revolution's turning out to be a very, very, very fun pay-per-view in booking so far. Moving on to match number three, the Women's Championship. We have Riho, my favorite women's wrestler, versus the Native Beast, Nyla Rose. Interesting take on this one. We've had Riho taking down everyone, and everyone loves her, you know, the smallest girl person winning, you know, so. Unfortunately, this one, Nyla Rose will take the win. Now, I'm not really going to get into this one too much because, you know, the controversy and stuff with the whole, y'all know what I'm talking about. I don't have to really go too deep into it. But on the bottom line of it, the bottom line of these matches, like I said last week, if I'm not entertained, I won't rate a good match. The match was great. I gave it 8 years out of 10. There was a little bit of awkward backstage drama when Nyla actually won this match. She walked backstage, you know, Tony Khan was there, you know, gave her a hug, you know. It was great, and then the other wrestlers just standing there staring at her. She starts looking at him like, really? Really what? What's going on? No bubbly? No bubbly for the Native Beast? What's going on, guys? Yeah, that was it. She walked back there. They all kind of looked at her, gave her like a sour face. She walked off. I'll say on that. Match number four. Woo! Match number four. Oh my goodness. Match number four of the night. MJF versus Jungle Jack Perry. The Jungle Boy. Yeah, man. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. I don't know. I don't even know what to say. I really don't know what to say. Whew. Match of the night. Match four was definitely match of the night. Oh my goodness. This is one of the best matches I've seen since, I don't know, the Dustin versus Cody Rhodes with the blood match. Oh my gosh, that to me last year was like one of the top contenders for match of the year in all of wrestling. So this one, it's not going to be a match of the year. I can say that straight out because the storyline isn't there to cement that part of it. But wow, man, MJF put over Jungle Boy like crazy, you know. Even though he's, you know, Mr. Superhero of the Universe, best still in wrestling right now. Whew. This match was great. Didn't see a single botch. Ooh, I mean, oh my goodness. MJF made Jungle Boy look incredible. You know, MJF is the kind of wrestler that, you know, he hasn't been around forever and ever, but he has that idea in his head. He knows how to put people over. I mean, there was a moment where, MJF was trying to do the dirtbag thing and, like, you know, trick him with the whole handshake, like, hey, come on, okay, let's do the match, come on. You know, Jungle Boy spits in his hand, does it, pulls him close, oh my goodness. Magic, just magic in the ring. This whole match was crazy. I mean, you had MJF, they had a, who was it, they had I'm trying to think here. I'm gonna get this straight, because this match was so exciting, it just, oh man, it jumbles my head up. Anyways, what I was saying was Brandi Rhodes was in the announcing booth with Jim Ross, Excalibur, and Tony Schiavone, you know. And she was helping a little bit with commentating. The whole, because MJF, you know, he has that trouble with Cody, and, you know, he turned on Cody. Brandi's sitting there kind of watching it, you know, see what's going on, because she's watching this whole thing from the outside perspective, you know, helping her husband, supporting her husband, and wanting him to get revenge on MJF for what he did to him at that title match versus Jericho. But, yeah, there was one point where MJF, literally, no joke, grabs his crotch, points at Brandi in the announce table, and says, you want a real man? You know, come over here. Oh my god, I haven't seen that since... Oh my goodness. I haven't seen that since, way back old school WWF. Man. It was crazy. It was funny. It was funny, but it was serious, and storytelling was there. MJF is going to take the win on this one via double cross finisher. Sorry, I'm going to have to keep moving. I'll talk about this match for the match was great. This is the first match since we started the podcast, and I'm rating 10 years out of 10. He's going to win this match with a heel win, obviously, because he's Mr. Super Heel, with that big old diamond ring that he won with that tournament, which was presented by none other than DDP. That's why I did that thing a minute ago. Wardlow came around the side of the ring, handed them the diamond ring. You know, ref didn't see it, obviously, heel tactic. Turns around, nails Jungle Boy, goes down, hits that double cross finisher, and that's the end of the match. Regardless of the MJF win, you know, I was pretty much expecting him to win, but wow, he put over Jungle Boy great. It was great. Match of the night, match of all week for me. So, last match of the night on AEW Dynamite. Another great match. This is a continuation of the storyline with the Inner Circle versus Mox leading up to Revolution with Jericho versus Moxley. We have Mox versus Santana in an eye for an eye match. Basically what happened last week, Santana got his eye gouged with those car keys that belonged to the GT car that Jericho offered Moxley to join the Inner Circle. He's going to give him a real expensive car and say, hey, join the Inner Circle, bud, come with us. You know, Mox obviously turned him down. Somehow I had the keys to it. Boom, last week, Santana in the eye. So this week we had Moxley with his eye patch versus Santana in his eye patch. Moxley's going to take the win on this one via the paradigm shift. Gave this match a 8 years out of 10. So, obviously, like I was saying before, the storyline they're doing, every week he's basically facing an Inner Circle member. 2 weeks in a row now, he's beaten them. I thought maybe next week he's going to have, you know, maybe Sammy Guevara, Jack Hagar, whatever. They're busy kind of doing their own little thing within Inner Circle and separate storylines. So, actually what's happened is, if y'all haven't heard of, Jeff Cobb is coming to the AEW, and he came to AEW last Dynamite, this one. But yeah, so like I expected, they all kind of ran in the ring, the Inner Circle started beating on Moxley. After they got finished beating the crap out of him, you know, we hear this music, everyone looks, Jeff Cobb shows up, comes out there, grabs Mox, gives him the Tour of the Islands finisher. So yeah, great match, like I said, 8 out of 10. Moxley, like I said, I don't know if he's going to beat Jericho. It would be awesome. It'd be really cool if he beat him. That would be amazing. But yeah, no, next week he's going to face Jeff Cobb. That will be Jeff Cobb's first match in Dynamite. And man, this episode blew me away. One of the best episodes. It would be a great episode if you're just starting AEW. Check out this last week for 12 February. Wow, just a great show. This would be a great intro for you to check out. And that's it for this week in AEW. I hope y'all enjoyed this episode. Be sure to like and subscribe. Hit that notification bell down below, and we will see you next time. Keep it retro.